So, well, now we are going to start. So, first of all, thank you so much for your participation. Today, we are going to uncover some of the mysteries, secrets, and untold stories from the colonial times of Peru, especially focusing in Lima. And we are going to talk today about the first mestizos of Peru. Mestizo, by the way, refers to the mixed blood people, the mixed blood children. And when we talk about the first ones, we are talking about the conquistadores, the children of the conquistadors, and of course, the Incan nobility, the Incan kings and princesses. So before we board the story of these children, these mixed blood children, I would like to tell you also a couple of things. First of all, the mestizos, the first mestizos of Peru, which were born in the first decades after the invasion or the conquest of the Spaniards, well, the biggest number of them belong to the lower rank indigenous, mixed with the also lower ranked soldiers of the conquistadors. And most of them were products of sexual abuse, rapes, or illicit unions, let's say, that were not under, let's say, the permit of the church, right? Because these were not even marriages, right? Many of these conquistadors who united with indigenous women here were married in Spain. So they couldn't marry anyone here because if they did so, they would become bigamous, no? So this is why many of the children of these, let's say, conditions of unions or even rapes, we don't know their stories. We know they existed, but we don't know much about them, about the traumas they lived. Today, I will be talking about three characters, three personalities of our history that are well known because they were children of famous personalities. And also, let's start telling you that the period of the history we're going to be talking about is the one between the two famous, maybe most famous kings of Spain of the colonial period, Charles I and also Philip II. So you can see Charles I on the left, Philip II on the right. The period that we are talking about is the beginnings of the 16th century until almost the end of the 16th century. Times of conquest and changes in Spain and especially in America. So we're going to be talking about three characters. Two of them women, one of them a man. In all of the three cases, we are talking about descendants of Incan royalty and also a Spanish conquistadors of elevated rank. First of all, we're going to be talking about Francisca Pizarro Yupanqui. Francisca Pizarro Yupanqui was the daughter of Francisco Pizarro, the great conquistador, the famous conquistador of the territories that nowadays we call Peru, also Ecuador, Colombia. So these territories that eventually became all of these many countries belonged before to the Incan empire, the Tahuantinsuyo. So Francisco Pizarro is remembered as the conquistador of this territory. And Francisco Pizarro united to Inés Huaylas, which was a Incan princess. We're going to talk a little bit more about this couple in a moment. Later, we're going to talk about Inca Garcilaso de la Vega, a famous writer also of his time. This man made different books, and the one I highly recommend you to check out is the Royal Commentaries of the Incas, which was inspired in his memoirs from his time when he lived in Peru, and he lived also under the protection of his Incan mother, Isabel Chimpu Ocllo. He was also the son of Sebastián Garcilaso de la Vega y Vargas, actually a descendant of a famous Spanish writer called Garcilaso de la Vega. That's why he also actually took the name Garcilaso de la Vega for that ancestor, but he added Inca at the beginning. And also another important personality is Ana María Lorenza Coya de Loyola y Zairi Tupac. Look at this long name. So Ana María Lorenza Coya meaning princess, Incan princess de Loyola, was the descendant of the last Inca king Zairi Tupac, and also direct descendant of Atahualpa, Huáscar, and all of those kings, Inca kings. So she was such a very important character, very powerful character. And she was the daughter of the sister, actually, of Zairi Tupac, the Ñusta, also that is another way to call a princess in Quechua, the Ñusta Cusihuarcay, and a Spanish man of very high rank, Martín de Loyola. So now we will continue. So Francisca Pizarro. So who was Francisca Pizarro? Francisca Pizarro, first of all, was the daughter of the great conquistador, the famous man, Pizarro, a man who originally came from Trujillo de Extremadura, which is located almost in the center of Spain, very close to Madrid, a territory that the name of the site, Extremadura in Spanish, means extreme and harsh. Extremadura is a territory that is very, very complicated, quite arid, so I have here also and read in some books. So that territory was harsh, and many conquistadors came from that territory, actually. In the case of Francisco Pizarro, he enrolled to come to America because he had no wealth of himself. He was an illegitimate son of an hidalgo, of a nobleman. There's even some interesting stories about the possibility that Pizarro descended from his mother's side from Jewish Portuguese that were in Spain. Seems that Pizarro was quite a personality. He had not access to wealth as he was illegitimate, a bastard son in his own country. So as many men also of his time, he decided to come to America to look for fortune. When he came to Peru in the year 1532, and he started the conquest of this territory, he was in his 50s. He was a man of weapons, a very, you know, hard man. He was actually like an elderly of his time, because back in that period, the life expectancy was for about, you know, 40 years and that's it, right? But he had exceeded also that limit, and he was a man well-traveled and well-known, but he was illiterate, which means that he did not write, not knew how to write and read. So he got in touch with Inca Atahualpa when King Inca Atahualpa was captured. And the story says that Atahualpa, which was a very wise man, actually, although he was young, he wanted to create a good relation with Pizarro. So he offered to Pizarro his sister. He planned that with this union, Pizarro will be convinced to make him freed, give him the freedom back, and also he could save his own life and possibly, you know, keep his status of king. So he offered his sister, Quispe Sisa. This was her Quechua name. Quispe Sisa was very young when this story happened. She was 15 years old only. And Pizarro was over his 50s. Huh? So to be more precise, they had 40 years apart difference. She was 15 and he was 55. What an amazing couple, right? What a difference in age. Of course, we don't know if there was any love between them, but let's put in the position of both. No? Quispe Sisa, you know, she was taught as a princess, as an Incan princess, to do whatever the King Inca will told her to do. And it was not unusual that princesses, Inca princesses, would be married to important men from other communities to create family bonds between them. Also, she was prepared to this destiny, possibly. Mm? In the case of Francisco Pizarro, he was escalating to the highest he could. You know, he would become, you know, nobility. No? And this is because in Spain, then local nobility was the Incan nobility, the American nobility was at certain point, like respected, you know, not completely, but the nobility here did not have to pay taxes, for example, did not have to go to work to the mines. They could keep wealth. They could keep also status, servants, lands. So, you know, it was better than nothing, you know, to be a nobility back in that time. But you should be submitted to the king, to the Spanish king. So for Pizarro, it was a way to legitimize his position in front of the indigenous. Mm? So the king of Spain did not like the idea of conquistadors uniting with princesses, because the low rank conquistadors were that low rank. No, so that was supposed to be a privilege of the elite. But well, Pizarro accepted to unite with Quispe Sisa, but she had to baptize first. So she turned into Inés Huaylas Yupanqui. That was her Catholic, her Christian name. Mm-hmm. So were united. Look at the differences in terms of the ages. Here we have Francisco Pizarro. Of course, they are not really paintings from his period per se, but many descriptions of him describe his face as very long, thick beard, you know, like a beautiful forehead, nose, you know, that like, gave him good character, no? Pizarro never married Quispe Sisa. Pizarro did not live too long with her. Mm? But they had two children. And here, you know, you can see in the map where is Lima, my city, and you can see Jauja, quite close in the center between Tarma and Huancayo. So after the killing of Atahualpa, but when Atahualpa at the end was killed, he was not able to keep his life. Atahualpa was killed, and Inés Huaylas and Pizarro continued together, and Pizarro established the first capital of Peru in Jauja. It was the year 1534. And in that same year was born Francisca, his eldest daughter. He had also another son with this princess Inés Huaylas, Gonzalo, but Gonzalo didn't live for too long. So, Francisca is known as the first mestiza of our history because, we know the history of her parents. You know, there is also lots of information about the date when she was born, the location, and also the biography of her. Mm? But remember, there were also other mestizos born in between, you know, 1532 and 1534. Huh? So, the first mestiza, was born in Jauja. And Jauja was the capital of these territories, but the Spaniards quite fast started to feel very down about this location. It was too high, cold in winter. The animals were not adapting very well. So this is why they asked the conquistadors to move into another location. And this is why a few time after, in 1535, January 18, Pizarro established Lima, or the City of Kings. And the family moves together to Lima. So, well, here it comes also the part of the explanation of how mestiza was this lady, how mixed was Francisca Pizarro. So Francisca Pizarro was indeed mixed by blood, but culturally, that's a different thing. Culturally, she was not mestiza. And the reason is because when she was here in Lima, a few, you know, like years after Pizarro and Inés Huaylas came to Lima, they separated. We don't know why, but it seems that possibly the union was, let's say, not that profound, not that deep for Pizarro to like to continue being with her. She was too young. One biographer also said that she fell in love of a page boy of Pizarro, I mean, one of the servants of Pizarro, much younger than him, and that maybe in his good heart, Pizarro accepted them to be together and united. And well, this situation at the end ended up in she being married with a close man of Pizarro and even producing children together. Mm-hmm. So Francisca was not left under the protection of her Incan mother. She was raised in the highest standards of the Spanish education given to even the nobility, because Pizarro was de facto a rich man. He was not nobility only from his relation with Quispe Sisa, but he was a rich man. So he wanted Francisca to have the best education, but he was a man of weapons. So he couldn't give this education himself. He was illiterate. So what he did was giving Francisca to a close couple of him, a half-brother of him and his wife, which became the sort of like godfathers and mother also of this young woman. In this picture you see here, the representation of Francisca and the representation of Quispe Sisa, well, you can see that Francisca has no elements of Incan origin. Her dress, her fashion, even the long face she has, right? Emulating more the Spanish roots of herself. But also it is true that back in the old days, the mestizos or the darkened skin people like mulatos, when they were represented, also lighter skin than they actually were. So one curious detail is that we have no love letters between Pizarro and Quispe Sisa. We have no documents, no commentaries from close friends of them. But we know only that Pizarro used to call Inés Huaylas Quispe Sisa Pispita, which is a Quechua word, which means in English, vivacious, vivacious, you know, happy. So because she was so young, right? So young, such a big difference of age. So, well, sorry, before we continue, something really interesting I want to tell you before we finish this part of this lady, which is the fact that she didn't die in Peru. So the story of Francisca ends in Spain. And this is because in Spain, after the murder of her father, Francisco Pizarro, here in Lima in 1541, after she was persecuted by enemies of Pizarro's here, she was so young, she was not even 15 years old when there were people that were asking to marry her because she had such a power. She was a descendant of Incas. and also the descendant of the great conquistador, she was a tool for success, right? So finally, the Pizarro family and even the king of Spain asked and recommended her to go back to Spain, because in Spain, she would be completely away from the revolts of produced by the Incas, who wanted to reestablish the Inca power. No? She would be more like a better merit. She would be found a good match that possibly will be connected with the crown directly. So, well, she was taken to Spain first. And once she was in Spain by request of the king, a second request came. That request was from the brother of Francisco Pizarro, so the brother of her father, the uncle of Francisca. So Hernando Pizarro, a man that also was quite elderly in comparison to her. She was sort of like 17 years old, and he was approximately 30 years older than her. So just to give you an idea. And she went there, and Hernando Pizarro was already united to a Spanish woman, by the way. He lived in prison in his castle. And this is because he was accused of sedition. He was accused of, let's say, standing against the king. And that's why he was taken to prison. He has such an interesting story. Also, check it out. Hernando Pizarro. So Hernando Pizarro was in his castle, and he had this woman, Isabel Mercado, and he even had children together, but they died very young, as the biographer says. And Francisca went to the palace, so young, so beautiful, so fresh, right? He saw her, and immediately after, he sent Isabel Mercado to a nunnery. And he put her in the nunnery, he got rid of her, and a couple of years after, Francisca is married to her uncle. One of the reasons of such union was the wealth of Francisca. She had lots of land in Peru from his father's side and from his mother's side, lots of wealth. And Hernando was so ambitious that he didn't want that money of the Pizarros to go away, to be spread and shared with all the family. So this is why he married his own niece. She had such a life, but she was able to have a happy ending. And you know how? When her husband died, he was about 70 years old, 74 years old. And well, she was free. But in the testament of her husband, uncle, he asked her not to marry again. That was his request, not to marry again. Something she didn't do. She became a widower at 44 years old. And 2 years after, she was married with a man 20 years younger than her. So they live such a life, and they spend all the money the Pizarro brothers made in just a couple of decades, in parties, in troubles, in charities, in lavish lifestyle. So this is how this woman lived her life in the last 20 years of this interesting, life that she had. So next we are going to explain the history of Inca Garcilaso de la Vega. And this is another famous character. And in this case, the first mestizo of Peru, but also the first cultural mestizo, I would say, of Peru. This is a different case. Mm-hmm. So here you can see Inca Garcilaso de la Vega. When we see that forehead, that nose especially, we see the Incan influence in him. And we see also this medal of the sun in the front. So this is the way, that, like him saying, I recognize myself as the descendant of the Incas. But this recognition, no, was not really happening when he was living in Peru. It had to happen when he went to Spain. And in Spain, he had also a very interesting life. He's a very contradicting character also for moments, but the last years of his life, he signed up documents and papers as Inca Garcilaso de la Vega, no? So, but he was not born Garcilaso de la Vega or Inca Garcilaso de la Vega. He was born as Gómez Suárez de Figueroa. And he was born a few years after Francisco Pizarro in 1539. This man was born from a royal, let's say, couple, no, an Incan princess, and also an Spanish man, military man of high rank, possibly one of the highest in terms of rank, one of the highest rank soldiers we had in Peru in that period of our history. So there is something really interesting about this man. Something that also didn't happen with Francisca and with the also character we're going to talk after, which was also a woman. In the case of this man, he lived with his mother during his whole infancy until his adolescence. So he had a very close relation with his mom. He talked fluidly Quechua and he had a vision that he inherited from his mother's side of the Incas, the grandiosity of the Inca Empire, the events, the most important events of the Inca Empire. So important is his vision of the history of the Incas that he received from his mother and from his relatives from his mother's side, that most of the information nowadays we use about that period comes from his book, the most important book made by a mestizo during the colonial times, the Royal Commentaries of the Incas, which he made when he was actually an elderly in his last years of life in Spain, remembering all the stories he lived when he was here in Peru. He sort of like an illegitimate son in terms that, well, his father never married his mother because he was an Inca princess. And, the kings opposed to these unions, to these marriages. This man, his father, never married officially with his mother, but possibly the most difficult time this young man or as a young man, Inca Garcilaso lived was when his father married a Spanish woman. So when this happened, it was too hard for him. No, very, very sad because his mother was put completely aside. No? And he became an illegitimate son. But a few years after this marriage, his father dies and inherits him a small fortune. And this fortune was for his education. So he used this money to return to, to go to Spain, to the land of his father, and ask for the benefits of a conquistador. Unfortunately, the crown denied those benefits because, the father of Inca Garcilaso de la Vega at some point helped one of the revolutionaries, the Spanish revolutionaries, actually from the team of Pizarro. This became a problem for him. He was denied of any benefit. And this is how finally decides to abandon any type of benefits given by the king, and he goes to another part of Spain to visit the relatives he had from his father. So in there, for example, he participated even in the War of Alpujarras in Spain, a war that happened in the south of Spain between Spanish and Moors. The War of Alpujarras happened because the Moorish community or the descendants of the Arabs that stayed in Spain after the reconquest of these territories, because they were for about 800 years under the domain of the Arabs, right? The south of Spain, especially, and a big part of them until the middle of Spain. So this community of Moors, they were seeing all their freedoms, all their liberties being cut out when the king of Spain, in that moment, King Philip II, asked them, for example, the women not to wear their veils, not to speak in their language, only speak in Spanish. You know, this was a reform that was, you know, thought to be a religious reform, no? So the people, the Moors, standing against the crown, you know, asking back their benefits, right? And you know something, this is one of the contradictions of Inca Garcilaso de la Vega. He supported the Spanish, you know? Although he lived in his own flesh the discrimination of being indigenous, he, in that moment, reaffirmated his Spanish side, no? And he fought for the Spanish side. Mm-hmm. So this is one of the contradictions of these men. So, but well, he became victorious also. And he, after that, was recognized also as a great military. But after that, he started to write, and he made lots of different novels. By the way, this is the zone where the Battle of the Alpujarras happened in the south of Spain. Also, in talking about the Moorish and Arab influence, we received lots of that influence in Peru. For example, the wooden balconies in the colonial part of Lima, no? The tapada limeña, the covered women of the colonial Lima as well. Some desserts, some foods also are from Arab tradition that eventually got into this territory. You know? So this is also another influence we had, the Moorish or the Arab influence. Hmm? So I was saying something about the royal commentaries of the Incas. Well, this was the most important book he made. It was pretty much his memoirs, his remembrances from his early years. And if you have the chance of getting this online, it would be fantastic. It would be fantastic. You will love this book. Although, of course, remember, he lived in a bubble, pretty much, because in the colonial times or in the times of the early conquest, we had two factions. We had two parties, no? The ones that supported Atahualpa and the ones that supported Huáscar. And he belonged to the group that supported actually Huáscar. No? So he had also a impression of things that was not of the common, let's say view. Also, another thing really interesting is that because he was Catholic, he proposed that the Incas were they prepared the land for Catholicism, for the Catholic Church to come, right? With some of the precepts, some of the Inca ideas, no? So he had a very sweet way of seeing things, no? But it's his way of seeing things, and this is something you should be able to read if you have the chance. Royal Commentaries of the Incas. Mm-hmm. And finally, we are going to sort of like analyze a painting, which is one of the most famous, most defined, most recreated paintings we had in the colonial period, which is the marriage of the princess, the Inca princess Beatriz Claracolla, and also a really important man, a Spanish man, who was Martin Garcia de Loyola. But the union of this princess and this very important man produced this woman, Ana María Lorenza Coya de Loyola Sayri Túpac. Look at that name, right? Name of the monarchy. So here we have the painting. This painting was, by the way, made by solicitude of the Jesuits. So how come we have the Jesuits involved in this situation? Well, the Jesuits, as well as the Dominicans, the Franciscans, the Mercedarians, the Augustinians, were here in Peru in the colonial times to evangelize the indigenous, first of all, right? That's why they were here. But the Jesuits are the last religious order that came to these territories, the last main religious order that came to Peru. And they had a duty. They came in the time of the big reforms. So they participated in the counter reforms of Spain. Times when, for example, the Protestantism started to become, you know, spread over in Europe. Spain was fighting it harshly, and also the Protestantism started to come to America, right? So the Jesuits, which, for example, the founder of the Jesuit order, which is one also of the most important religious, you know, figures, Ignacio de Loyola, San Ignacio de Loyola, I think you would call it Ignace of Loyola. He was a military man. And then he became a monk, right? So the Jesuits came to Peru around the decade of the 50s of the 16th century. And when they came here, their work was to evangelize the indigenous. And the way they thought would be the best to evangelize them was through the education. So they started to build schools. And they oriented these schools to the Incan nobility. Remember that when the Spaniards came, there were lots of revolutions, Inca revolutions. We have the one of Sayri Túpac, for example, or Túpac Amaru the First, right? And it was a difficult time for Spain because they wanted to stop all of these revolutions. And the best way they thought was converting all of these indigenous from the top, from, you know, the higher ranked people into the Catholicism. So the Jesuits were here to do that. And they offer education, high education, to these noble Inca men. But we now know that the Jesuits eventually got their own agenda about this, because these schools they created, they became, you know, places where the European ideas started to come, but also other ideas about, for example, the independence, you know, even the freedom, you know, and these indigenous started to understand also with the understanding, with the information is power, right? So, and the Jesuits seemed that they were supporting these groups. How we know this? Because some of the biggest Incas, indigenous revolutionaries of the colonial times, studied in Jesuit schools. And this is not just my belief. Actually, later, Spain kicked out from America all the Jesuits. It was the year 1767 when the Jesuits were expelled from Peru. And all their properties were confiscated. But this means also that, you know, there were the proofs enough of this happening, right? But I am going too far in the future. In this moment, let's see now the painting we have over here. This painting is usually known as the marriage between Beatriz Clara Coya and Martin Garcia de Loyola. So who is this couple? Which ones are the people we are talking about? Here you can see them. Beatriz Clara Coya in her beautiful indigenous dress. It looks like silk, what she's wearing, right? And we have here, you know, this gentleman, very refined, Martin Garcia de Loyola. He was not just a common person, by the way. He was a descendant of the very Ignacio de Loyola, San Ignacio de Loyola, San Ignace of Loyola, the founder of the order of the Jesuits. So here we have part of San Ignacio de Loyola uniting with the Inca nobility. And we have also another couple over here. We're going to analyze little by little this. We have, we have this young lady that you are seeing next to the gentleman in black. So that lady is the daughter of Beatriz and Martin. Her full name is Ana Maria Lorenza Coya de Loyola y Sayli-Tupac. So we have here the influence of the Incas, the Coya princess, you know, Sayli-Tupac is also coming from her, one of her uncles, Las Incas. And we have Loyola also from San Ignacio de Loyola. And she married also another important person. She married Juan Enriquez de Borja, descendant of Francis of Borja, Francisco de Borja, or San Francisco de Borja, which is also represented here in the center of this painting. That's why we have two Jesuits in the center. So what is very interesting about this scene is that the painting is portraying two marriages that happened in a space of approximately 30 to 40 years between one and the other. One happened in Cusco and the other one happened in Madrid. So one in Peru, the other one in Spain. How was this possible? No, these Jesuits were creating this compose. This is a scene that has two complete different, moments and locations. And everything looks, to be matching perfectly. Like everything is in an ambience of peaceful and happiness. This was a publicitary tool of the Jesuits, in front of the indigenous to show their status, to show their power also, and their connections with the Incan nobility in such way that the very Ignatius was connected with the Inca kings, right? Through this marriage of Beatriz and Martin. Also, we can see another element. We can see Cusco, for example, over here, with the Inca king behind, right? And we have all the dresses, the traditional dresses. We even can see a temple, like a church made of stone, like with some elements that look Inca, but also some elements that look Spanish. And on the other side, we have the representation of Ana Maria with Juan marrying in the Cathedral of Madrid. So from here, we can see a couple of elements too that are interesting. We can see that the princess, the Inca princess, Beatriz, she's dressed up and also her skin is as dark as an indigenous, right? But in the case of Maria or Ana Maria Lorenza, her skin is white, completely fair. She's not the daughter of an Inca. She is an Spanish, And when women, usually this is the case of women, of the women, daughters of mestizas, of conquistadors with Inca princesses, we can see, the intention of taking off from them all of the Inca traditions, right? And converting them into Spanish women. We don't know really much about her feelings, if she spoke Quechua or if she, had a closer relation with her mother. Usually it is very common that children of this kind would be separated from their mothers early in their life. Here we have a last image. This is the fragment, of that painting. Nowadays in Peru, we have 6 paintings three of them exist in churches, the other 3 in private collections. three paintings of this kind, of the marriage of Beatriz and Martin. And as I said before, they were used as a, let's say, promotional, you know, tool of the Jesuits among the indigenous. Mm-hmm. So here another one, for example, this is the same story, you know, but different author. Mm? Most of these paintings are from the 17th century. Mm-hmm. And in this case, we can see that, well, Ana Maria Lorenza is slightly darker skin, right? Slightly in comparison to her mother. Mm-hmm. So what about the other mestizos? Well, we don't know really much about the other mestizos, but we know that we are the descendant of the other ones, because the royal ones, the royal ones, unfortunately, well, they didn't stay in Peru. In most of the cases, they were taken to Spain. And this is because where they were so important, there were such important tool for in the hands of the Incas and let's say the ones that were fighting the Spanish king, that were trying to bring back the freedom here. So they were so powerful that they shouldn't be left easy to be catched by them. So that's why they were taken to Spain, and most of them died in Spain, and their descendancy is in Spain. So the other mestizos, well, the common ones, we are the children of those common ones. And we are the children of the mixed blood, Spanish, indigenous, the Spanish with the Africans, the Spanish, you know, with later the Chinese, the Japanese, and so on. No? So, but this is, let's say, an introduction to what mestizo means and how was life for the first mestizos in Peru. Thank you so much for your participation. I hope you enjoy this little lecture.